York Second Baptist Church on Wednesday night. I'm glad to be here with you tonight on this, the fifth day of May. And wow, this year is, every time I say a date, it's like, where has it gone? We're changing formats as of right now. This very minute, we're meeting in the building on Wednesday nights now. And we do have something for every age of a person. If you're joining us live stream right now, I appreciate you here. I'm going to look straight to camera. And I'm glad you're with us tonight, and I appreciate you sharing. But there's something going on in the building right now for anybody and everybody that would want to come and be a part of that. Our 4th through 12th graders have been meeting way back over there in that corner for some time, and we've been keeping that corner sanitized for them. Tonight we have the ability to work with the younger children as well and the adults in this room. So if you're not here tonight, next Wednesday night, at 6:30 for the adults, at 6 o'clock for the young people. If they get here before 6, there's some snacks available usually for them, and we're able to share in that. But we're going to be here, and we're glad to be what some have called waking up from COVID. We've been a little slow, and that's all right. We are being very careful to be sure that we're not moving more quickly than we should with the difficulties that we're facing. We want to be sure that what we're doing is safe. We'll be back in this building again Sunday morning, 9:30 is Sunday school. Again, there is a place for everybody. Our kids are age graded, our adults are, we call it age graded, but we're more interest graded. Kind of, there's some classes that have some older folks and some younger folks in them, and that's okay. Something for everybody at 9:30 on Wednesday and on Sunday morning, and then at 10:45 morning worship, we'll gather here. And so that's just good, and good to share, good to have a part of. Just before we came on tonight, we were talking about Falls Creek, and that's one of my favorite places. We're on our way to Falls Creek here in just a few weeks. Children's Camp is starting on, I just put my book down, it has the dates in it that I wanted to look at. Children's Camp starts on June the 2nd, and Youth Camp for our church is June the 21st, and you can get with our children's workers. And our youth workers about the specifics on that. But if the young people want to go to camp, have to know that very, very, very quickly because we have to turn in numbers and get reservations, and we have to, there's some different kinds of checks that we have to do, different things. So please get with our youth workers and our children workers and get more details about that and let us know what's going on there. And Senior Adult Pastor Association coming up. We've got a deacon. All kinds of stuff, and the world is still turning, and God is still in control, and Mr. COVID just didn't win. He just didn't win. God had to stop being God, and I like that. He had to stop being God from way back when, and he's not going to stop being God. We've been studying in Genesis, and the lesson, the piece of scripture that I pulled out of there for tonight, Genesis chapter 35, beginning in verse number 8, wow. There's a couple of changes in here that just have to be noted if we're going to see the whole story of Scripture. Let me just pause and say, one of the reasons that Genesis is so vitally important to learn the story of Genesis, to see the timeline of it, to try to grab some of the geography of what's going on, and to know who the people are in Genesis, is because within the pages of that part of Scripture are the covenants that formed that which God was going to do all the way through the rest of the history of the Old Testament and then into our lives today because of what he did to Jesus in Genesis. Listen, if you don't grab Genesis and don't understand the significance of some of those things and some of those places and all of that, you're going to miss what Jesus is teaching about when he goes to the temple and he talks about the gold and who it belongs to. You're going to miss some of that. You're going to miss a lot of what Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount when he says, you've heard it said, because those laws that were given by Moses and presented to us in Exodus and Deuteronomy and Leviticus, those things were prefaced and even foretold in Genesis. And of course, creation is in Genesis. And how what God did to bring this earth about. And it's not enough for you just to say, I believe that God brought this about. You've got to say, I believe that God wrote it out this way, if you're going to have a solid theology. And whether you believe it to be as I believe the Bible teaches, and let me say that differently, as the Bible teaches, not I believe the Bible teaches, because really what I believe doesn't matter. Nobody said amen to that. I'm glad. Thank you. What the Bible says is what matters. It doesn't matter if I think it's sinful and wrong or not. The Bible says sinful and wrong, it is. No matter how I feel about it. It doesn't matter if I like the story or dislike the story. If the Bible gives the story, then that's where we are. And the Bible says that in 6 days, with a morning and an evening, God created them again. That's what the Bible says. And if you're going to grab that, and if you're going to come into Scripture and grab that literal of an understanding of what God says, instead of viewing it all as an allegorical tale through the whole thing, that's going to shape how you view God. Who do you think God is? Did he do it in six literal morning and evening days, or did he do it in six periods of time? Well, the word day in Genesis there, the word aeon, it's the word from which we get our word eon, which can mean anything. To a little kid, an eon is 35 seconds, right? To you and I, an eon might be 3 or 4 years in the course of humanity, and what science is trying to call it, an eon could be hundreds of thousands or millions of billions of years. But if you're going to believe that it was an era, was the first day, that's going to take how you're going to be God, how you're going to experience yourself. Grabbing into Genesis is important. And getting to this spot in chapter 35 is pretty significant in the whole turn of what God is doing as he brings Messiah to us. And so tonight I'm going to call your attention to just about 8 or 9 verses here. And we're going to look at these verses. And I want to pull a few truths out of them because it's important to put this in its place in the story. And then as we come together next Wednesday night, I'm going to try to have some maps with you. And we're going to back through a little bit of this and watch how this moves around in the maps and see where some of the geography of it is. But in chapter number 35 of Genesis, beginning in verse number 8, we read this. Now, Deborah, Rebekah's nurse, remember Rebekah was Jacob's mother. Now Deborah, Rebekah's nurse, died. And she was buried below Bethel under the terebinth tree. So the name was called Allon Bachut. I probably said that totally terrible for anybody that knows anything about Hebrew. Verse number 9. Then God appeared to Jacob again. And when he came from Padan Aram and blessed him, and God said to him, your name is Jacob. Your name shall not be called Jacob anymore, but Israel shall be your name. So he called his name Israel. And God said to him, I am God Almighty. Be fruitful and multiply. A nation and a company of nations shall proceed from you, and kings shall come from your body. The land which I gave Abraham and Isaac, I give to you, and to your descendants after you, I give this land. And God went up from him in the place where he talked with him. So Jacob set up a pillar in the place where he talked with God, and a pillar of stone. And he poured a drink offering on it, and he poured oil on it. Jacob called the name of the place where God spoke to him, Bethel. And may God add his blessing to this reading and to the hearing of his word. Here's the deal. Jacob has made a great big trek over the last, some say 14, some say 20. I tend to lean on the 20 years since his mother sent him away. And his mother sent him away. You recall the story, I hope, because we've been talking about it enough lately. His mother sent him away because Esau was about to kill him. His older twin brother was about to kill him. So his mother, Rebekah, went to his father and sent Jacob away for just a few days. And that's significant now. Might not have seemed significant when we first looked at it, but some 14 to 20 years later, it all of a sudden becomes a little bit more significant. Let's look at verse number 8 and see why. Deborah was Rebecca's nurse. The term nurse simply meant somebody that cares for, waits on, serves. And it also had in it somebody that takes care of those physical things when one is no longer able to take care of those physical things for him or herself. And so it was just a person that tends to another person. Baby has a nurse. And all of the things that you might think that a nurse would do for a baby would be things that a nurse would do for an older person, just like today. And so the word there is not just companion, it's not just servant, it's somebody who takes care of the intimacies, takes care of the delicate things that we're not going to continue to try to not describe, okay? But Rebecca, Jacob's mother, Isaac's wife, apparently had died. We don't know much about that. We're not given a lot of details about it. But I want you to grab this. Rebecca went to Isaac and said, listen, we need to send Jacob down there to Uncle Laban's house so he can find him a bride. And then he won't get one of these pagan women, you know? So let's send him down there for a few days, a little bit of time, see if he can. And some 14, 20 years later, Jacob comes back with two wives and grandbabies, right? But Rebecca's not there to see him. The last time Jacob saw his mother, apparently, we're not told exactly when she died, but he hasn't made it all the way home yet. The last time he saw his mother was when she sent him away. There's a lot of lesson right there, isn't there? She sent him away because of fear. Sent him away because there could have been some retaliation. There were threats being made. Perhaps there was some anger. She sent him away after they had together colluded to rob the older brother Esau of his birthright and of his blessing. She sent him away expecting just a few days. That being a couple of decades, and in that time, she apparently died. Deborah was Rebecca's nurse, and probably it fell on her then to come to Jacob as he was coming in. When Esau's entourage went back, and there was quite a bit of distance to cover here for them to go back. And when they got back, probably Deborah had heard, and so she thought, I need to go and talk to him and tell him. Because I remember when he was little and I was taking care of his mom and different things, and I need to go and talk to him. And the assumption that most scholars have written is that Jacob welcomed Deborah into his house. She became like family to him, if you will. She became one of the household of Jacob, part of that entourage that was moving with them. And while they were covering the miles to get them where they needed to go, and while they stopped and waited when they needed to wait, for the children to rest and for all of those things to happen, there Deborah died. And interesting that it was such a special thing that when she died, we have again some things mentioned that we need to keep track of a little bit. We have the terebinth tree. You remember the terebinth tree? There, Isaac pitched his tent, didn't he? We got Abraham. And somebody laughed, I remember Sarah, by the terebinth tree. All through, we see people meeting at a terebinth tree, and I still don't know exactly what one is. There are a couple of different ideas I put on the internet as to what one might be, but apparently, there was this terebinth tree that is called the terebinth tree that is so close to Bethel that they got to find all this stuff, and that's the special place for them. It's a place that marks something. It could have been a group of trees. It could have been a little oasis area, and there was this great big, huge terebinth. I don't know, but there was a burial place. There, the nurse. Speaks a lot to us. Number one is be careful how you talk company. You never know if that company's going to come back. We've talked about that quite a bit. Number two is something that we learned from Mr. Wright. helpers. He was talking about firemen and policemen and all that, but he was also talking about doctors and nurses. And Deborah was a helper. We should always look for the helpers, because if we look for the helpers, then we know who to thank and know who to learn from and know who to emulate and try to be like. If we look for the scornful and the skeptical and try to be like them, the world's just not going to be any better, is it? But if we look for the helpers and invite the helpers into our company and be a part of what the helpers do and help the helpers if we can, I think the world might just get to be a little bit better. Of course, then honor comes even to those who do the most menial things. For there is honor in some of the most menial things, even things which Deborah had to do for Rebekah until the day that she died. Now, that marks the timing of all of this, right? There at Bethel, they have reached a place where they just got to quit roaming. They've got to do this stuff. They've made a full circle from having been there before. Jacob having met with God there before. We see that back in chapter 32. They have been a long, long journey. If you have the maps that you look at in your Bible and you look at where Haran might be versus where Bethel might be and all of that, and Bethel's not too far away from Jerusalem, and Haran is quite a distance away. Shechem is not close by. You remember Shechem? Was a place that they had ugly dealings with the sister Dinah that we looked at a couple times ago. It's all right here. It's a lot of traffic. This was not one day and then another day and then another day. This was one time and then they traveled some. They didn't get in the motor home, drive 80 miles an hour, down like 40. They walked beside the camels. And when they stopped and pitched the tents, usually they didn't just pitch for a night. They walked and made a day's journey, and then they would stop and rest a couple for the small animals that were checked on. So we see that there's some timing in here that goes. The significant moment of the timing is it is here that the person who might have been like a second mother to Jacob is now dead and is now buried. But something awesome is about to happen. I love the wording here, and I love it when I looked at it in the Hebrew just to find out if this word was actually there or if it was put there for those of us that speak English, because in verse number 9, it says, "Then God appeared to Jacob." That's great in itself. Then God appeared to Jacob. But then there's the word. That phrase doesn't quit right there, does it? Then God appeared to Jacob again. I like that word. I like it when God does something again and again and again and again. And what God's doing here when he appears to Jacob again is not just showing up again to say, "Hi, how you doing, buddy? Glad you're having a nice time. And sorry about your mama and sorry about Deborah and all of that. But boy, I'm glad that you got to get along with Esau and that you guys are brothers again. And in the time you grew up and you didn't grow apart and all that." I think that's just wonderful. "Well, I'll see you later." This was no social call. This was no "I hope you feel good" call. This was another time that God appeared to Jacob. I hope that you have had many experiences in your life. And they're probably not going to be in this day and time as vivid as they were in that day and time. God has revealed himself so much with so much clarity and plainness in the course of history through the prophets and through Scripture and through his Son and through his Spirit, that today these kind of manifestations are not what we look for to hear from God. Can God do it? Sure. Might God do it? Maybe. Does God do it? If he does, I've never had the kind of experience that Jacob is having. I don't know of anybody who tells me the story that they have that I can feel good with it. So I don't know. I'm not going to say God doesn't appear to people. I'm going to say if he does, I haven't had that experience. But what I am going to say is that even if you don't have that experience, you can be in the presence of God again and again and again and again. Because you see, this was before the Holy of Holies was made, and we're after the Holy of Holies has been opened. Okay, you get this? Jacob and Isaac and Abraham heard from God on several different occasions. And they didn't hear from him at a temple. The temple hadn't yet been built. They didn't hear from him in the synagogue. The synagogue system hadn't even started yet. They didn't hear from him at the worship service at the downtown Baptist church at Bethel. They heard from him in person up close. And then as God began with his intimacies toward man, and that began to not be what God wanted to do to speak to us anymore, he began to put together a system of relationship with them that we call the Jewish religion. And he laid down laws for it and said what kind of buildings to build and what kind of sacrifices to give and what kind of clothes you're supposed to wear while you're giving the sacrifices and what words you're supposed to, all the things that go along with it. And he set that up. All of this stuff pointing toward the fact that he knew mankind needed a redeemer and he was going to send that redeemer, and every bit of it, including this encounter with Jacob, points to the fact that he intends to send a redeemer to mankind in the person of Jesus. See, and so here he comes again to Jacob. Now Jesus has come. Now he's died on the cross. And with his shed blood and his death paid the price for your sin, paid the price for my sin. That place called the Holy of Holies that represented the presence of God that was hidden from everybody's eye except the high priest was open as the curtain was torn from the top all the way to the bottom. And when that thing was open, then it's was another symbol, another picture for us to say we can have an experience in the presence of God with boldness. We don't have to peek behind a curtain any longer. That's what he's done with. And this experience is a precursor. It's part of the picture to help us to see that that's there. And it says, God said, God appeared to Jacob again when he came from Padan Aram, and God blessed him. Jacob blessed God too, by the way. Verse 10, and God said to him, some familiar words, you'll find almost the exact phrasing in 32:28. And God said to him, your name is Jacob. Your name shall not be called Jacob anymore, but Israel shall be your name. So God called Jacob's name Israel. Now, I tried to make a whole lot out of Jacob and Israel and the names and what they meant. Jacob is a name that means supplanter or heel grabber. You'll remember in the birth story that his brother's body appeared first, but then and so that was marked to make sure that they counted it correctly. But then Jacob was the one who was fully birthed first, and then his brother. So from the very beginning there was that struggle, and so he gets the name of heel grabber. You're trying to trip somebody up so that you can get ahead, and he exemplifies that through his life. That's what Jacob means. But in chapter 32, when he's wrestling and he says, tell me who you are. I'm going to tell you who I am. But I'm not going to let you go until you bless me. Okay, he blessed him and took care of that. But he said, this is your name. Your name's not Jacob anymore. Your name is not thief. Your name is not scandalous one. Your name is not supplanter. Your name is going to be Israel. Your name's going to be fighter. Your name's going to be one who contends. Your name is going to be that which is synonymous with the people who are going to be these nations and these kingdoms and all of that. So, well, we get the same words here in 35:10. That he says, your name is Jacob. It's not going to be called Jacob anymore, but Israel. And God called his name Israel. And God didn't quit there. God said some words that are very similar to words that we saw him say to Abraham several times, and we saw him say to Isaac several times, Jacob's father and grandfather. And words that were like this, maybe not these exact same words, but words like this that convey the exact same thing. Verse 11. Also God said to him, I am God Almighty. And there's a phrase right there, isn't it? All that we would really know. That we really, really, really know that he is God Almighty. Sometimes I don't think we believe that. Sometimes I don't think we really grasp that he's God Almighty. We need to do examples of how we don't grasp that sometimes. Sometimes we don't grasp it when we try to argue with God concerning the the direction that we know He's leading us to go. I'd do that, God, but that's not the way my grandpa did, and I think I'm not going to do it that way. You know, a lot of people, I might get in trouble for this, but I'm going to say it. A lot of people went to the ballot box like that. But much less, not the way my parents raised me, not the way we counted our math equations when we were in school. Not the way we did church so many years ago. If we would really know, I mean really, really know that He is the God Almighty, we wouldn't argue about whether or not we get to choose Him or He chose us. We'd all just be down at His feet worshiping in reverence and in awe of the very nature of God. Instead of worrying about whether or not I have free will or not, we get down to the more important business. If we really believed that He was God Almighty, we wouldn't lazily slop by in our Christian walks. We would want to get into the Word of God as often as we have a chance to, and we would want to hear the preaching of the Word and learn the teaching of the Word, and we would want to fill our mouths and our hearts with the songs of worship and praise to Him, and the things that we say about other people would be good things about other people instead of always tearing other people down. And the reason that we would come together as a church wouldn't be so that we can sit in a room that is air-conditioned to our comfort level and sing the songs that tune to our ears just right, but we would be here saying, God, You are the God Almighty, and I'm here in worship with You. I'm here in reverence to You. If we really believe that He is God Almighty. If we really believe that He was God Almighty, we wouldn't be trying to gain our salvation. I'm not just for sure, but I hope I'm going to get to heaven because I did enough good stuff. And my good stuff, I mean, I just really make sure karma's on my side, you know? Every time if I do something bad, I make sure I do two things good. Well, first off, who's defining the good and bad? God Almighty. If He's God Almighty, how are you going to make up for saying to God Almighty, I'm doing what You said don't do? We really believe that He was God Almighty. There'd be differences in this world. Or we would no longer tolerate that which God calls sinful and accept it in our lives. I'm not talking about anybody else. I'm talking about us. If we really believe that He was God Almighty, then we would be calling ourselves His people who are called by His name, and we would be humble and pray and seek His face and turn from our wicked ways, and knowing that when we did that, He would hear from heaven and forgive our sin and heal our land. Listen, God's not going to punish the United States for the sin of the lost. He's going to punish the United States for the sin of the church. If we really believe He was God Almighty, we'd be more concerned about that than how many people are going out and wasting their money gambling home. Or how many people have had abortions, and both of those are significant to know about. Those are important issues to be on our hearts. But we really believe that He was God Almighty, and that people who reject His free gift of salvation through His Son Jesus Christ, that He is precursoring to us in this. We really believe that He was God Almighty. The thing that would be on our lips the most would not be the latest TV show that we watched or that favorite song that we preferred. The thing on our lips would be the sweet love of Jesus Christ and the grace that He offers. For by grace you've been saved through faith. And that's not of yourself. He offered you grace. He offered you grace so you could be saved. You've been saved so that you can live and work for Him and give Him honor and glory. And we really believe that He was God Almighty. That message of grace would be what we're talking about. If we really believe He was God Almighty. At some point in Jacob's life, as his name is changed to Israel, and as he becomes the father of nations, and the rest of the passage reminds us that his name has changed and has been called the father of nations. Verse 11, I am God Almighty, be fruitful and multiply. A nation and a company of nations shall proceed from you. Kings shall come from your body. The land which I gave your grandfather Isaac and your grandfather Abraham and your father Isaac, I give to you and to your descendants after you. I give this land. I think Jacob probably believed that, don't you? And if Jacob believed that, he not only believed that he was going to be fruitful and multiply and kings and generations and peoples and land and all that thing that he said, but he's going to believe that it was God Almighty making the promise to him that this is what it's going to be. I'm not so sure. They were fully convinced. He's God Almighty. I may not be so transparent with you tonight as to say, well, I hope I am, and I think I might be. Really God Almighty, then he is all powerful. And he can say to me and do to me whatever he wants to say to me and do to me and cause me to be whoever he wants me to be and call me to do whatever he wants to call me to do. He's got that availability and that power. In fact, he's got the ability to force me to do even what I don't want to do. If he's God Almighty, we want to sit and argue about whether he's God Almighty. Get busy about doing what God Almighty said. Get busy about being a people that he's called us to be so that we can, in our place and in our time and in our thing, be like Jacob was and understand that he's got a name for us and that he wants us to be fruitful and multiply. And that's reiterated to us in the New Testament, that when he talks about a tree is known by its fruit. And when he talks about a Christian that is giving honor and glory to God and is my Father's glorified, that you bear much fruit, he says. That we're going to be a nation and a company of nations. And he tells us to go into all the world, preach the gospel to all nations. That word again is echoed to us in the New Testament by Jesus Christ himself, as he does. And then the land and the place where he gives us. Feel inclined one more time to say, we really get all these lines. We quit trying to argue about whether or not he really is God Almighty. If we should bow ourselves to him more than I have ever done in my lifetime, sir. Perhaps more than I've ever seen. Recognize and understand without having to get run around in circles and without having to have the Uncle Laban experiences and without having to have the fear of Laban coming up, without having to have the fear of Esau coming from the other direction, and without having the experiences with Shechem and all of that stuff that took place with Dinah in the preceding couple, three chapters. Without all of that, God shouldn't have to do that stuff. He shouldn't have to flood the earth to remind us that he's God Almighty. He shouldn't have to kick us out. Do. If we really believe him, we might actually ask him to do it. And if we ask him to do it, whether he accomplishes it the way we ask him to or not, he'll show us that he's God Almighty. And he might just do it the way we ask him. Verse 13 tells us that God then went up from him in the place where God talked. Physical presence left him. God went up from him. That's what verse 13 says. God went up from him when he got done talking with him. And what did Jacob do? He did what he's been doing all over the place. And frankly, it was probably a common practice to be done. He set up another pile of rocks. Verse 14. So Jacob set up a pillar in the place where he talked with God, a pillar of stone. And then here's something interesting. And he poured, verse 14, he poured a drink offering on it. And he poured an oil offering on it. This is the first place in Scripture that a drink offering is mentioned. We don't have the law from Moses yet. We don't have all of the ceremony laws telling us how to make sacrifices and all that. None of that's been written down. This is before Moses was even born to write all that stuff down. You think maybe God Almighty didn't change his standard at all? And he told them what he wanted. And he said, I want an offering out of that which you have. And what he had was a drink. And so he poured a drink offering. What he had was some oil. And he poured an oil offering. And the kind of offering might not be as important as the heart that gives the offering. You're going to give what you have simply because you know it's God Almighty. And you know he's visited with you. And you know he's told you, whatever it is that he's told you, maybe it's something to think. Maybe it's something to say. Maybe it's something to do. Maybe it's something to stop thinking or stop saying or stop doing. Maybe it's something I can't even conceive of myself. Maybe it's a place to go or maybe it's a place to stay. But in him giving that to you, he's reminded you he is God Almighty. And he set up a pillar. There he gave offerings. First time we've heard of the drink offering here. We get it described later. Verse 15 says, and Jacob called the name of the place where God spoke with him. You know this? You know what Bethel means? Hey, how do you spit that out? Bethel? Bethel? House of God. Guess what? Interesting side note. He spoke to him there, and because that's where God spoke to him, he called it the house of God. That Bethel name, we would say Bethel, but the Jewish people would say Bethel because El, God, want to emphasize that. But that very tradition of calling that place where God spoke to him that name is where we get off calling this place the house of God. For here, when we gather together as a group, not in exclusion to anywhere else, but that this seems to be something about a place set aside for God to speak, we expect to hear from God. Most of the time when we come, we expect to hear from the preacher. And I hope I come up with something from God to say to you so that when you're simply hearing my words, but God's alone. You've heard me pray that prayer hundreds of times. But do you come to Bethel expecting to have an experience with and hear a word from the very God Almighty? As he's setting up history so that Messiah will come. Here he's beginning what will be the children of Israel, the 12 tribes of Israel, who live in the land of Israel. We become the people of God through whom Messiah will come. But before that, they're going to wander in the wilderness for 40 days, and they're going to be taken captive, and they're going to go to war, and they're going to be sinful, ugly people, and they're going to be blessed and beautiful people because they've been righteous. And then what God said, and they're going to go back and forth and generation after generation, and this and that. Finally, one of these descendants of Isaac, or Jacob, Isaac is Jacob's father, but Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel, is going to be called Jesus. He'll save the world from calling, or he himself. You've heard about the God Almighty, but you can't say, I know who he is. You've heard the stories about all these guys we're talking about, but you haven't put all this together, that it's the same God some 3,500 years ago here, dealing with people so that you and I could know salvation and have experience with God Almighty who spoke to Jacob that day. Those that have never come to you and don't really get where we're going, I pray, Father, that